If you've been following the nerdy end of the news, you will have seen headlines this week along the lines of scientists discover new shape. And I was like, well, hang on. Who are these scientists discovering a new shape? What do I mean by new shape? Are there any mathematicians involved? And obviously I wasn't the only person wondering this because people started to email me and send me messages saying, Matt, can you explain what this new shape, the SCOO-toid or SCOO-toid, is? And I was like, you know what? I want to find out. The problem is, I'm currently traveling through, I don't know, generic foreign city somewhere in the world because I'm doing shows for high school students, details below. So to be able to explore this shape and see what it is and how it behaves and if it is indeed new, it's time for another installment in everyone's favorite stand-up math segment, Matt makes a shape out of things he found around the place he's staying while on holidays. Let's do it. Welcome to the rather echoey dining room of my Airbnb. It's furnished with all the most generic decor that IKEA has to offer and a lot of bare walls. So anyway, I've got some cardboard I found around the house. I've got all the Australian staples. There's barbecue shapes and Little Creatures pale ale. Thankfully, I've got tape with me and I found a pair of scissors and I was able to locate some pipe cleaners. Now, the SCOO-toid is a member of the wider family of prism or prismatoid shapes. So before we get into the SCOO-toid itself, we're going to start with shape number zero, the prism. I've now got a collection of pentagons that I've cut out of shapes. And I've got hexagons from Little Creatures. Now, a prism is just when you've got two identical parallel faces and you join up all of the vertices. So I'm going to use the pipe cleaners to do that. Okay, and there we go. There's my pentagonal prism and my hexagonal prism. Now, of course, these faces should be filled in rectangles. I've just done the edges and left these empty, but they should be filled in the same way that the ends are filled in. And these are your standard issue prisms, nothing that exciting yet. However, that's not the only option for making a prism. If we actually take a pentagonal prism and give it a twist, I can sneak a few more edges in there. So our original prism here had hexagonal faces and then all these faces joining them are rectangles. Because of the twist, I've now got in twice as many edges going around and two edges meet at each vertex, I mean, plus the, you know, edges on the top. And so what I've got here is an anti-prism. If your two parallel identical faces line up and you're using rectangles as a prism, hexagonal prism, if things are skewed and you use triangles, antiprism. So that's now shape number one in the prism family, the antiprism. Slight detour off the prismatoid path to a pyramid. It's a, you know, hexagon-based pyramid. This is not a prismatoid because it hasn't got a pair of parallel faces anywhere. But you could imagine, like if you sliced off the top and put a new face in there, it would be parallel to the bottom one. That's exactly what I've made here. So this is a frustum. That's shape number two, the frustum. This is what happens if you get a pyramid-like shape and you lop the top off. Well, it works with cones as well. You get a frustum shape. It is a prismatoid. It's yet another variation on the theme. So now we have the prism, the anti-prism, and the frustum. One more to go. Okay, so what I've done now is I've put a pentagon on the top and a hexagon on the bottom, but to join them together, well, there's more vertices at the bottom than the top. So two of the edges, which I've done in yellow here, have to meet. And so this bit here, to patch the six vertices at the bottom to the five on the top, I've used an anti-prism triangle here, whereas the rest of it is prism rectangles. Now, in maths, There's not a special name for this. This is just back to the generic name prismatoid, right? It's got the parallel faces. All the ones in between have four or three edges around them. It's a prismatoid, but it's some combination of, it's a bit prismy in some bits, it's a bit anti-prismy in others. It's a mix of the two, doesn't get a special name. So I guess our final category is just prismatoid, which is kind of everything else. But now, there's one more. So this is it. This is our SCOW-toid or SCOE-toid. It's the same with our generic prismatoid before, but instead of the anti-prism triangle face all the way up, you've got like a Y. So you've got a little triangle face, and then over here, you've just got your standard single edge coming into the top. So you could say a SCOW-toid is a prismatoid at one end, and then it's a prism at the other. So it's kind of halfway between a prism and a single triangle prismatoid. So there you are. I mean, that's it. I guess the most important bit is this bit here where it merges a little like Y or V shape. So in short, there's pentagons to the left of V, hexagons to the right. Here, YM, stuck in the middle with SCOO-toid. Hey, that's pretty good. That's so good, I'm taking 5 minutes off. Actually, while I am taking a break, earlier on today I had a chat with my friend Laura Taalman, who was working out how to 3D print one of these. Which is not easy because these faces are no longer all flat. You've got this concave bit here, this weird kind of five edged face is no longer well behaved, and so 3D printing that is not trivial. And we'll get to in a moment, these things are meant to kind of stack together. So I asked Laura how she went about designing a 3D model for these.
So when I first tried to make the SCOO-toid, I did sort of the most boneheaded thing you can do, which is just to put vertices in the shape of a hexagon and then below it in the shape of a pentagon and then have an extra vertex and take the convex hull of all those vertices. That didn't work. Some of the sides have to be curvy. They're not actually planar faces. The SCOO-toid isn't a polyhedron. The next thing I did after that is I divided the object vertically into slices and kind of lofted a slice at a time. So each slice was not curved, but then it approximated this nice curved surface going up. And then I did get an object that was nice and curvy and looked like a SCOO-toid. It looked pretty much just like the SCOO-toid that's in the picture in the article. However, it didn't pack with itself. It turns out that the locations of the vertices, and in particular the location of the extra vertex, are really key for determining whether a SCOO-toid will pack with itself. But there's ways that you can constrain it to make that happen. And the final model does have this property that it packs with itself. Now, I was doing all this in OpenSCAD. You can delete that if that's not interesting. But I was. I did this in OpenSCAD.
So what does a SCOO-toid have to do with packing and biology? Well, there are cells in biology called epithelium cells, and they form an epithelium layer. And biologists just always assumed that they would be prisms that have formed, well, obviously distorted prisms. The cells would grow and fill the space and just, you know, have a face at each end and be joined up normally in the middle. And whenever there was some kind of curvature or the surface was distorted, then it's a frustum. It's a truncated pyramid arrangement. But then biologists spotted patterns and curvature in these layers of cells which couldn't be explained by truncated pyramid-shaped cells, and so they got some mathematicians involved. Yeah, thank goodness there were some mathematicians involved. Once the biologists saw these strange shapes, some mathematicians came in and they thought, well, how would we model what shape these cells would form if they were packed into these various arrangements? And they used, well, a variation on a thing called the Voronoi technique, which is where you put a bunch of points in space and then you expand them until they fill all the space, and each region around each point are all the other points which are closest to that original starting seed point. And then they looked at, in the 3D arrangement, how these cells would form if they were trying to like minimize the energy but find a stable arrangement where they pack together as efficiently as possible. And that is where they came up with the SCOO-toid. The mathematicians predicted that these epithelium cells would have a different number of edges on one face compared to the other face, and the edges would merge somewhere in the middle, giving this prismatoid arrangement. I was actually lucky enough to talk to one of the mathematicians involved in the project, because I knew they were in there. So I had a chat with Clara Grima, and she explained a bit more about how they found this shape based on what the biologist told them.
Hi, Matt. This has been the first time for me that we worked together with biologists, physicists, and computer scientists. And I think that the role of everyone was quite important. In short, we, the mathematicians, had to formalize how to define the new shape that biologists have observed in the microscope. The group led by Luis Ma Escudero, biologist, had observed that the usual representation of cells of the epithelial tissues, prisms or truncated pyramids, could not explain some properties that they observed in the microscope. So they asked us to try to find the correct model. With the first model, we made some predictions, but they were not still accurate. So we have to change our model. And finally, with the SCOO-toid, everything worked fine. Finally, we have the seat of approval of a physicist. He proved that the SCOO-toids are stable when they pack together.
The mathematics didn't predict that all epithelium cells would be SCOO-toids, just enough to give you the right curvature. So for the case of a cylinder, which happens in animals apparently, or some kind of spheroid, you would have a certain percentage of these. And it's quite nice that it's built out of pipe cleaners, because it's not some fixed, rigid shape, right? But it's not, you know, it's not like a cube or something like that, but nor is it quite topology, because there is some geometry. Somewhere between topology and geometry, they worked out the structure that would be required in some cells to give these sorts of shapes. And then they found it. They looked in fruit flies. They took what the mathematicians told them, and the biologists were actually able to find these shapes inside little creatures. It's a phenomenal collaboration between biology and mathematics. There may be applications as well. I was chatting to Clara, and she said that one day, if they look at tissue actually in, let's say, humans, and they know what structure to expect, they can tell if the cells are growing normally or not. Or if we ever make artificial cells, we need to know what kind of structure they form. So at the moment, it's all very abstract, it's all very exciting. You can read the full Nature paper if you want. I'll put a link to it below, it's publicly available. One last bombshell that Clara told me when we were talking is that this shape here, which gives it the name SCOO-toid, in the media, officially, it's because of a beetle, right? It's named after a very similar shape you will see in beetles. Biologists. But when I was chatting to her, it turns out that was not the original reason for the name SCOO-toid.
This is funny and cute for me. Officially, it's because a part of the body of a beetle is very similar to our shape, the SCOO-toid. Okay, but there is a hidden reason, and I will tell you secrets. The biologist leader of the project is called Escudero. Translated to Latin is scutum. So from scutum, as a joke, we start to call it SCOO-toid. Later, we cannot think another known name for our shape, but SCOO-toid. Bye, Matt. May the SCOO-toid be with you.
Thanks so much for watching the video. There are more videos of me building things out of stuff I find while traveling. You can subscribe to my channel for all your mathematical needs. And thank you so much to all my Patreon supporters who make these videos possible. If you come across more maths in the news or something interesting, drop me an email. I'll see if I can make a video about it. And finally, the shows for high school students I was doing in Sydney are over, but I do them all the time right across the UK, and we'll be in New York for the first time in October. Details below.